Here today, it's a good chance for me to tell you something about how to manage daily life as possible in same situation in war, I mean. So I will start just to give you an idea what I'm going to tell you. Some details, some stories, prophet stories, something happened with me, with friends, with what I saw in the way to the work, what's happened in the work, whatever. So death and destruction are everywhere in Syria. Syrians are a good, open-minded, and joyful people. However, the war has taken everything from them. Today, they constantly face destruction and death. So what I'm going to tell you about, just I would like to read to know how what I'm going to tell you and how many things you have to arrangement in same situation like war or civil war or conflict. So first and the most important thing is safety and housing, destroying houses and refugees camp inside and outside Syria, economic problems and their effects on Syrian society. Everyday survival and condition in the besieged area. Electricity and heating, transportation, difficulty of movement and arbitrary arrested. Hospitals and medical supplies, school and education, children's toys during the war, university life, and something, and of course, fleeing to the country to Iceland in Europe, and something from my experience during this conflict. I would like to start to say, like, Syria was before a very happy country, full of happiness, joyful. We have a lot of many things, many festivals everywhere in Syria. You can see in the image, for example. You can see, this is, for example, sorry, this is Palmyra Festival, and we have a lot of parties. We have a Song Arab Festival, we have Coast Festival, Badia Festival. I mean, we have all of these good things that make the people happiness, like in Europe, I mean. Here, for example, in Switzerland, there's a fast for harvest, fast for every time there's some activities. I'm just living close to Basel. All the time there's some activity just to make people happy or sharing or for the kids, for everything. And that was the situation in Syria before the conflict. And then, and also in Syria, there's always, we call Syria like a mosaic. So it's full of many, many religions, many, many ethnic people living in Syria for 100 years together. And you can see this is this image or photos coming from Aleppo, where I have to work more than 10 years. You can see the Umayyad Mosque and one of church. And you can see in one image the church and the mosque together. So we, no problem, no religion problem at all before in Syria. No ethnic problem in Syria before. So this is something completely new for the Syrian society. This is something coming during or through this conflict. We don't know it before. Just an idea, like professor has shown us before, just to give impression to you how the situation in Syria. So it's a big mess. Fighting lines everywhere. And you can see it very well. For example, or maybe this one is better. For example, the red color is the regime areas. And you can see the regime is here and there. And here it's fighting lines in these areas. And of course, all the time, the fighting lines is in a civil place, not in the desert. Fighters fighting in the desert, no. All the time there's fighting lines during the civil houses. This is why I want you to see this map, because a lot of fighting lines everywhere. So regime and the rebels and the Kurdish and ISIS everywhere, somewhere here and everywhere. And all of this separated area between each groups is the fighting lines. And the result, you can see it here in this image. So they destroyed everything. They are not respect human being. You can imagine how you respect culture, heritage, or the houses of the people, of the prophet things, no, at all. So destroying and destruction for the houses, for the civil, normal people is everywhere. Sorry. So you can see the most of the fighting lines is in civil houses everywhere in Syria. So you can imagine how it's safety, this place, for example. Most of them is coming from everywhere in Syria, actually. But this may be coming from Aleppo, because I was living there. But in Homs is the same. In Daraa is the same. In the countryside of Damascus is the same. East, west, north, all. Shooting and fighting everywhere. And you can imagine how it's safety in the areas. I said that because, for example, this is just a story about safety. My older brother, he was a doctor in the Faculty of Agriculture in Aleppo University. One armed group is coming to his house and took him. And we don't know anything about him for 1 month. And then we pay a lot of money to get him back after 1 month. Of course, they stolen everything. And it's happened not for one group. They all did the same. They arrested people for no reason, and then they ask for money or for one thing ever. And for any kind of reason. I don't know why it's... Anyway, after all of this destruction for the houses, it's normal for a human, for anyone. There's fighting, there are bombing everywhere. It's normal that you take what you can take, if you can, I mean. You can take whatever you can carry it, and then you flee, you run away. You are looking for a safe place somewhere. And that's what's happened for the most of the Syrians, actually. And you can imagine. I always said I would like to imagine how this old woman carried in these plastic small bags. They left them houses destroying. And they are lucky because they're still alive, by the way. Because most of the families are losing member or someone, member or arrested or dying everywhere from all colors in Syria. Not only from the opposite or the regime. No, all the people is suffering and dying, I mean, because it's a fighting, it's a war. And you can see also in the photos, it's most of them are kids, children, women, most of them just are looking for a safe place. And of course, the first idea coming to them mind to going to a neighboring country. And that's what's happened, actually. There's a big fighting in south of Syria, in Daraa, they are fleeing to Jordan. And when it's happened, for example, in Homs areas, they are running away to Lebanon and the others, to Iraq or to Turkey. Sorry. And of course, you can imagine how the people is, I mean, coming to a country, it's not only 100 or 200, so they can hiring houses for them and put it somewhere and looking after them. No, it's a number, it's a big number, it's millions. Now it's not millions or maybe 12 millions. I mean, need help in Syria. But not all of them is outside Syria. There's a lot of camps inside Syria. And you can see it here. This is just some camps. It's inside Syria, but it's close to the border because they feel that this area is a little bit safety for them, more than same houses or same areas or whatever. And you can see how the life is going on. I mean, the daily life, because my lecture is daily life. So once I want, because this is close to my area, by the way, Turkish border. Once I went to one of these camps and I saw something you can't expect it. Everything in these camps, you have to stay in lines. Even if you would like to go to that toilet, you will stay in lines for 1 hour or I don't know. So life in Syria, actually, I call it by myself, it's lines. So you stay lines to get bread, you get lines to take to get water, if you get, by the way. This image actually from this year, 2015. And you can, I mean, what I don't know what I have to say, but I mean, the photos is paying about itself. But it's really a very bad situation. And I mean, in other camps, for example, in outside Syria, for in Jordan or in Lebanon or others, they get some support, but inside, they get support, but it's not enough. Some photos from the camps outside Syria, Jordan, as you see, millions of people living in tent in the desert. And in Turkey and in Lebanon. And really they are suffering from these camps because, I mean, they need everything and there's not many things it's getting, I mean, to them. I'll come very quickly. You can imagine how it's them daily life, I mean. How they are playing the kids, for example, or how they're cooking, or how preparing bread. And I would like to say something also. It's prophet things. By the way, in my house, for example, I, with my mother, we prepare bread with this instrument. But we don't have this. We have an old satellite. We clean it, satellites, we clean it and we put it in fire and we prepare some bread. And we are lucky because there are some meal, I mean, corn, we can prepare bread. And also we can see how they are cooking because there are not a lot of cooking material or oven or whatever. As I said, so, life, in, it's like that. So, for example, this line is waiting just to get some water. And this kids is waiting just to get some food or whatever. Or this sugar or spaghetti or whatever, because I mean, sometimes they are offering for the people or bringing for the people some food material from spaghetti or sugar or whatever. From international organization, by the way. So I will start with bread because if you are lucky, I mean, after you waiting for a while, you will get some bread. And you can see here how is satisfied this man after he's waiting and getting some bread. And for me, sometimes I would like to go to this place to get some bread. And I wake up very early, 5 in the morning, in my region, not in Aleppo city, in my region. Because my region is in the areas of the opposite and the museum is with the regime. And I will tell you some stories about this later. And I got early, 5 in the morning, and would like to be the first or the second or whatever. So I saw in front of me more than 200 men. And I stayed maybe the whole day for 10 hours, then I get some bread. And here in this photo, it's coming from my village. In our own house in the village, we have this, we call it tanur, and it's known. And as I said, if you are lucky, you will find meal and you can prepare whatever you want. Yeah, and this also. And unfortunately, in the cities, for example, in Aleppo or in some areas, I saw a lot of movies or YouTube movies. Sometimes there's a long line and then some mortars coming from this side or this side or the plan is coming and shooting them. So it's mixed blood with bread. And we can see it here with this. Water is to getting a water, it's another story. As the professor said, sometimes there's the place that Aleppo have to drink water or the drinking water coming to Aleppo is controlled by ISIS. So it's in their mind. They cut it, okay, there's no water at all in Aleppo. But there is some underground water somewhere in Aleppo. So the men or friends of me, they are spending, I don't know, 2-3 hours just to getting a gallon or a box of water, and then they have to go for first floor or second, third, fourth, fifth floor every time. I mean, if you are lucky, you get the water. So it's become more and more difficult. Sometimes you go to an underground sibling somewhere in the village, I mean, and you can use water trunks to bring it to your home, and you have a kind of this trunk, and you can put it for you, you can use it for drinking or whatever. And also, of course, kids always, all the time, being a part of this activities. Once, when I was working in Aleppo Museum, there's no water, drinking water at all, because in the museum we have underground water, but it's not allowed to drink because it's not good. It's not drinking water, it's something wrong in it, I mean, if I good explanation in it. So it's a dirty water, you can say, like that. So because there's no water for drinking, we just coming to our mind that we're boiling this water, and then when it's getting cold, we can drink it. And I try it, and then after 2 hours, I have a stomach problem or whatever. But unfortunately, after, I don't know, at that time, maybe 20 days, 22 days, there's no water in Aleppo at all. So the water is coming after, and then and for mineral water or water, you can buy it. No, there's, of course, if there is, you can't buy it. Because if it was 50 Syrian pound, it become 500. And I will tell you something about the salaries later. Besieged area is another thing. It's really, I mean, the worst happened in the areas for the people, for the human being, is having in besieged areas. Because all groups is using this way for controlling. The rebels and the regime, both. So the rebels, there's a Shiite village, for example, they control the all sides, no food, nothing getting on, and nothing going on. And the regime did the same. All, they're using this. What they can do? As it's very clear, yeah, hunger has no religion, yellow covers their basic area. This young man is writing in his T-shirt. This is actually a photo from a video. It's coming from countryside of Damascus called Al-Hajar Aswad. And this is a besieged area, actually. And this boss is looking for a piece of bread. And if you hear the conversation, you can imagine how they are very angry because someone is throwing this piece of bread in the ground. He said, why you do this? And this one, or sometimes there's some kind of organization, they can cooking for them, but it's not enough. It's a life. It's not only for one male or two males. It's no. Sometimes they eat some kind of grass. It's natural in the village, in the field. They try just to eat it or whatever. And of course, the prices in besieged area. For example, it's 100 kilogram of sugar. It was 100 Syrian pound when it's upping twice or third time. But in these areas, it's become 2,000. And actually, from where these people will, there are no job for them, nothing. They lose everything. If you stay in these areas, I mean, all the jobs before, or most of them, is belong to the regime. And if you are against the regime, you lose your job. So no salary for you. From where they are organizing? Or they're using, by the way, to getting, for example, sugar or tea or bread or something, they are using canal for 2 kilometers, 3 kilometers, or whatever. Like what happened in Gaza, maybe. Just some details about how the electricity. And of course, I mean, because of the shooting and the fighting and the war, of course, they will, all the electricity lines, it's destroyed or completely destroyed. Or it's destroyed and then after 1 month, 2 months, they are repaired or whatever. So we people, I mean, return 50 years ago and using the kerosene lamp. And we use it in my home, by the way, this kerosene. We have one. Or candle, if there is. Or this fire kerosene oven, or whatever you can call it. And I have a silly story, because my father was very angry because my mother is giving this instrument or this oven to someone or buying it for us antiquas, antiquities, old things. And my father was very angry from her because she did that, because it's become this, sometimes it's become this very valuable. And it's, if you would like to get a new one from this, it's 3,000 or 4,000. And nobody before caring about this at all. Or the man who is preparing this, he become rich man, because a lot of people is bringing something they are storage from 20, 30 years to fix it again. Something about cooking, heating, or in winter time, of course, because in sometimes in winter they are freezing for one or 2 months in Syria. So they're using, of course, the wood for firing, or for example, fireplace here, and you can see all the families is around. And actually, by this war, when someone has a small house in the village and he was living in the city, so all the families coming to the small house. So you can see in one house maybe 3-4 families, and of course they are using only one. Of course, it's emergency situation. I mean. And sometimes they are getting warm or cooking or whatever. And also I have, because I'm here, I have good chance to tell you this, my prophet story. Once I invite my mother to a chicken, and I go to bring 2 kilograms, and I would like to cook it. But if I would like to go to use gas instrument, it will take maybe 2-3 hours. And gas, it's 6,000 Syrian pound, only one, I don't know, gallon or what, yeah, tank or whatever. So I spend maybe 3-4 hours just to bring, but I do it, actually. School damage, it's another story, because early in this conflict, most of the fighters is using schools as an armed center. And when you use something like this as a center, so the other is coming and shooting you. It's normal. And that's what's happened in our school, actually. And so most of the schools have been damaged or bombing, or they use it not for education. And I would like to say, I'll be honest, that education in Syria is very, very important for the Syrians. Most of the families have high education, most of them. By the way, my mother don't count or did not read or writing at all. My father also. But I am here, I get my master. My older brother is a doctor in the university. So education is very important for the Syrian family, because most of them are normal people. I mean, not very rich, very, very high rich, I mean. So education is very, very important for them, was. So for that, even in the camps, even if the school is destroyed, they use it some rooms, they use it some tents, just to get information, just to get education, just to get knowledge, good knowledge, I mean. And you can see just some. Children too, during the war, is another story, because our children is become they are not a good place because they are losing the school, actually. And this is the area in the opposite, by the way. In the area of the regime, it's still a little bit, it's better than the areas of the opposite. Because the areas of the opposite, there is not good organization at all. They said there is a school with no teachers, no books, at all. So this is the difference. There's some kind of difference between areas and areas. Where is the Kurdish controlling? Maybe it's better. where's the regime, maybe it's better, the opposite is worse, or it's depend from areas to areas. So you can see the kids are playing for the rest of the war, with car bombing or guns or whatever. And you can imagine also in these photos, and you can see the background of these photos, there is no village at all. Actually, our kids become professional to knowing the kind of the fighting guns. When they heard the voice, they said, "Ah, this is Kalashnikov. Ah, this is NATO. This is Doshka." Because of all the time they are hearing this. University life. I was also sharing in one or two subjects in University of Aleppo as a teacher there. So, and during this conflict, before I was maybe 150 students in the third year in archaeology in Aleppo University. But for example, in the last time, it was only 40. 2014, I was there, and it's only 40 students. So more than half of our students, of my students, they are just looking for, they lose them study, I mean. Because they are with the opposite, for example, or they are afraid from military surface, or whatever, for different reasons. You can imagine. I mean, it's a war, and you can imagine whatever. And sometimes there's some mortars or some rockets. It's coming around the area, the university area, or whatever. You can see it in the image before. And of course, I mean, as the students are divided, one with the opposite and the other with the regime, so it's happened everywhere. Actually, it's happened in the same family, this divided. For example, I have a good symbol. It's happened in my village, friend to me. He has four boys, four was in the military regime. Two of them, they don't want to continue and they are become with the Free Syrian Army or with the opposite. And they're fighting each other, the two brothers, I mean. And it's like that in Syria. So in the family, you can see some people with the regime, one with the opposite, one with al-Nusra, and the worst, if there's someone with the ISIS, he will kill the all, if he is someone with the ISIS, by the way. Yeah, hospital damage also. It's same like what's happened in the schools. For example, this is Al Kindi Hospital. It belongs to the University of Aleppo. It's very famous. All specialization was in this hospital. But they took it as an army center, so the other is coming and shooting them. And you can see the result for this. And it's not only for the co-structure, I mean. Even if there's, for example, in it's just an example, in Afrin, and it's controlling by Kurdish, it's a little bit safe area, but there is hospital, maybe more than three, four. But there's no doctors. So what we can do? Children, the vaccine, it's another story. Because I'm really suffering, me, by myself, with these children vaccines. I would like to go to a normal injection for my little daughter, because you know it's every 2 months or 3 months, it depends. And there's no at all in our region. So I'm starting looking for another village, another town. No, it's only in Aleppo. So I have to go to Aleppo, not in normal way. I mean, it's danger. You can all the time running away from the fighting lines. To get some injection for your kids. Actually, there's a very, very sad story happened in the opposite areas, in Idlib region. There's some victims was out of the surface or out of the dead or expired, and they use it for the kids. And from this action, there's more than 50 kids had been died from this. And me, myself, when they are coming to my village, I always took my daughter and running to them, actually. So you can imagine how is the feeling for the fathers or the families there. So, coming back to the refugees, because it's now in all of newspapers and media talking about Syrians and the Syrian refugees. And I would like to say that refugees are the victims of terrorism, because if you agree with any of these fighters, you will not leave the Syria. You will stay with what someone you agree with them, and you fight with them. It's like that. If I agree with the regime, I stay with the regime and fighting. Most of these people are not agree to what's going on in Syria, but what we can do. Most of them are, you can see, old people, children, women, and they are just running away from the fighters. And it's, I mean, this immigration or this abandoned the areas, it was before in the borders, and then in the neighboring countries, and then to Europe. And they start using the Mediterranean long time ago, 2 years. It's become long time. They use Mediterranean, they are going to Egypt, and then by Mediterranean to Italy or Greek, or to Libya. How is dangerous Libya? They are going there. And some people, some stories, I heard it from friends, arrested in Libya for more than 8 months. And then they can have a way to come to Europe. And most of them died in Mediterranean. And then they found this another way. I mean, and they used the blam from, you know, maybe all the stories. So I don't go in the details, I mean. And they are coming to Europe. Just something about me. As I said, my roots is coming from the areas. It's west of Aleppo, about 40, 50 kilometers. So it takes from me every day to going to the museum for 50 minutes, 1 hour. And in the last time, it's become more and more difficult. You can't go in the normal way. You have to go to another way, because there's a lot of fighting areas interrupt you somewhere. So you have to go to another way. And in 2012, Aleppo was divided. North Aleppo and South Aleppo, one with the opposite and one with the regime. And then only to get the regime area, where most of the envoys of Syria is going through this passing, because there are no another road. So most of the people who are working in the regime area, and it's a lot, they should come from this way. And I am, because I'm working in the regime area in the museum, so I have to come from this way. And and in this way, it's a long way, more than 600-700 meters. You have to walk. Not only you, maybe 500,000 is going and getting through this passing. And sometimes they are shooting each other. And I mean, for me, maybe it's no problem, so I can run away or find some walls, trees. But for the woman, for the old woman, for the something who is problem, health problem or whatever, what they can do? And you can see some image from this passing. Now this passing, it's only for humanity situation, because they are using another road. They call it, it's a military road, but they use it for the civilian, for the people, for traveling, to getting to Aleppo or getting from Aleppo. And so this is Aleppo, and this is, yeah, here is my village in this area. So it was only 40 kilometers. I go every day. I don't have a house in Aleppo. I'm living in the village, and every day I go and back to my work. But last year, in 2014, you can't go this way because it's closing, and this passing is closed between the both. So you have to come this way, like that. So you go to middle of Syria, to Hama here, and then to Salamiyya, and then to Albadia, and then you have to go. And this is a military way. So it's mean in any minutes ISIS or the opposite will shooting each other, I mean. So you have to cross some fighting lines around. And before I was with minibus, by the way. It's not big bus. Minibus for 10 hours. It took 10 hours, 12 before, and sometimes 10 hours, and last time maybe 8 hours because they are founding some ways here in the Badi, in Al Badia. So it's become more shorter. But before I was buying, for example, 30 Syrian pound, and in this case I have to pay 2,500. And this is, I have to say something about the salaries. For example, for me, my last salaries I get it from the museum, it was 23,000 Syrian pound. And if you convert it by euro, it's become 80 euro. And I have to pay more than half of this salary for the road, because one, Hin and Suruk. So, and for that, it's, and of course, for eating for myself, and the half is going to my small family in the village. Of course, during this long lines, you can imagine thousands of checkpoints every 2-3 kilometers. Every 2-3 kilometers, there's checkpoints. And they asked you, from all colors, by the way, from ISIS, from Al-Nusra, from the opposite, rebels, Free Syrian Army, regime, all. And they ask you, what you are doing? What your position? With who you are? So if you go to the regime area, we call you, it's Arabic word, Shabih, and that means you are fighting with the regime. And if you come back to your village, and it's with the opposite, the others, the regime and the others, said, you are terrorism, because you are working, living there. So what you can do with yourself? Of course, you are not agree with this, so I have to go to my work, and my work is in Aleppo Museum. I don't want to be with you, or sometimes I'm, if they ask me, I said, I am a teacher, or I am a worker somewhere. I never said that I'm working in the museum or whatever. And of course, if anyone, I'm not talking about the regime, I'm not talking about the opposite, if anyone from this don't like you, your face, maybe he will arrest you for no reason. Or there's something in Syria, it's very similar, that the names in Syria, it's similar. So, for example, me, Muhammad Fakhro, maybe there's 10 Muhammad Fakhro. Maybe there's 5 Muhammad Mustafa Fakhro, the name of the father, I mean, the same name. And if there's someone is, I mean, wanted to the regime, for example, and I'm passed to this, and they say, you are Muhammad Fakhro, come to me. And then you go to an investigation, or maybe you are arrested for 1 month or 10 days, I don't know. If you are lucky, 10 days, by the way. There's one story happened with my friend. He was the director of the prehistory section in the museum, and he would like to go to get a passport. And then they look to his name, and he's coming from Deir ez-Zor areas, from Al-Ishara, and it's controlled by ISIS. And ISIS stolen all the identity cards from that region and doing something wrong. So till they arrested him for more than 12 days, till they are clear that this is not the right man we wanted. And now I'm happy that he's now in Lyon, in France, coming with this all immigration. So all of this, I take all of this road just to get my job in Aleppo. And this is just some image about Aleppo. This is just an idea about the old city of Aleppo, because I feel I'm belonging to this area, because I spent most of my time in the museum, in the old city, in the citadel, in the last 10 years. And this is in you can see it here, the location of the museum. And here is the citadel. Yeah, Mirko told you about it, and the Umayyad Mosque. And of course, the old city of Aleppo is very famous in the world, because the biggest covered markets, it's in Aleppo, more than 300 kilometers of lines between houses, 12,500 traditional house in Aleppo. And you can imagine how the situation of in the ancient city of Aleppo, because it's become half with this part and this half with this part. And they're fighting each other. And you can see in these photos what is the result of these fightings. So it really was a market full of life. I mean, from everywhere, all over the world, they are coming to Aleppo, and they are coming to the old city of Aleppo, old souk, Al-Medina, they called. And then they're fighting each other in the aid, and then they're destroying everything by burning bombs from the plan of the regime, and from the opposite, they're using the water canal system, and the bombing the whole building from under the ground. We spent just more than 3 years, just our effort is going for protection effort for the museum. And we because we are not so far from fighting lines, so some mortars or if there is burning bombs somewhere in the ancient city, so we have an earthquake in the museum all the time. And it's happened twice, third day, it's normal, I mean. Shootings, you hear shooting. In the morning, you are going in the inner curtain and you see a lot of shells. We calculate it like that. Yeah, some mortars is going on in the outside curtain of the museum, but and we are lucky it's not bombing or explosions. Once there's bombing for a buildings, and then the stones is coming to the museum. And by the way, all the stuff was there, not only me. Most of the stuff was there. And once there's one mortar is going to close to the museum, and you can see the result of this was my office in the museum. And it's completely, there's no glass for the windows at all anymore. And I would like to say, in the last time, I can't go every day. I mean, I spend 1 day to get my job. So I stay in the museum for 3 weeks, and 1 week, I go back to my family. Not only me, there's 4 or 5 from my friends. Each one is responsible about one section in the museum. For example, classic museum, Islamic museum, Syrian Antiquities Museum or Prehistory Museum. We all living in the museum and spend most of the time in the museum. Yeah, most of our effort is going for protection, so you use sandbags, and you can imagine how is the situation, or how is the museum is look like now in this. All the small, just an idea what I was doing, all the small object we transfer to a safe place outside the museum. What we can is unmovement statue or sculptures, we can't move it, so we try to make a sign, a kind of protection in situ, like what we did in Ishtob Elom statue. It's from Mari kingdom, from the second, third millennium BC. We just make it a cement wall around just for protection if there's any bombs or mortars or fragments or whatever. Sandbags, it was not a good solution, so because it's damaged, so we are looking for another solution, so we make a wooden box for each pieces and fill it with sand, just as this is kind of protection. So I'm coming close to end my presentation. I would like to say that we don't want our generation to have a knowledge or ISIS knowledge. Because now ISIS is putting in the mind of kids, because they are controlling the areas and they are really strong controlling. So they are doing with the kids whatever they want. So even if this conflict will stay for a long time, so we will lose our generation, I mean. And you can see the reaction in the faces of these kids. Of course, they don't want this at all. And this is just something that I would like to share you, that even with there's a besieged area or there's people with in the opposite or in the regime, they are in situation is better than the kids in the ISIS areas. Here they are fighting to become alive, to make them games, tools, or whatever, to be happy for in fast of Ramadan or in another kind of fasting during this conflict. Because I mean, there's no way for them to live in normal life. This is for the people who is still inside Syria. And I would like to say that we are looking or hoping that everything will be better. We hope, it's just a hope, because if we lose the hope, that we will lose everything. So we just waiting. For example, this lady is written in her hand, "I want my life to come back." And I agree with her that everyone in Syria would like his normal life to come back. Safety life, I mean, with schools, with everything, I mean, like before. We don't want any more freedom or democracies. This is just an image that we are looking also for hope. They are just growing up some flowers in Raqqa. And most of this image is coming from Homs, and Homs in Syria, it's very famous, like a joke people. They always made joke things or happy things, even during this conflict. So in we all hope that the smile will come back again for the Syrian people, and they will have a normal life, normal school, and good education, and most of them become doctors or architect or whatever, and that's washing, hoping, waiting for a solution, I mean. It's very difficult, but I mean, we are full of hope that this war will end not so far in future. And my final statement, Syrian people are human beings. 9 million Syrian refugees all over the world were forced to leave their homes. Not only their homes, but also their mosque, church, as well as all of their belongings have been destroyed by the war. They are victim of terrorism and world politics. We should not forget that most of them are good-hearted people, many of them women and children, who only desire to live in peace and to have a future. And thank you very much for your attention.